Just around a month ago, I was offered to do this TEDx talk. Of course I agreed, and I needed a topic. To find some inspiration, I went on Google and YouTube, and I clicked on a video I like. The worst I expected were two back-to-back 15-second unskippable ads, and I did get them. But before that, I got this, a Capcha test. I thought, no kidding, I'm not a robot, so of course, I click on it. And it prompted me to select all squares with street signs. And I thought, this can't be too difficult, like, just be human, right? So this is a square with street sign. That's one. Those are squares with street signs. But then I started to doubt myself. Like, is that a square that counts? I mean, it's technically not a street sign, but it's part of it. And same thing over there. I mean, there's like a 1 millimeter protrusion of the street sign there. So do I click it or not? And, you know, this for rent sign, does that count as a street sign? I mean, it's a sign by the street, but it doesn't really give directions. And this square, I mean, it's a bit blurry. There might be a sign over there. Do I choose that one or not? Like, I'm getting confused here. And I thought, like, whatever, let's just go for it. And I got it wrong. And I'm like, am I even human anymore? So for those of you unfamiliar with Capcha tests, they stand for completely automated public Turing tests to tell computers and humans apart. But a recent study actually found that AI is surpassing humans in its ability to do Capcha tests. And, you know, a lot of people here are worried about the future of AI. It has been a massive change maker and will continue to be one. It'll continue to take over human jobs, and some even believe it will take over the world. But I'm here today to reassure everyone that that will not happen, because AI will kill itself. And I already see the panic faces among high school students thinking like, oh my god, I'll rather let AI take over the world than not being able to use ChatGPT for my essays. So don't worry just yet, there's still some hope. But first, how can AI self-destruct? It's not exactly going to be like the Terminator 2 movie where, you know, the AI will willingly send itself into a pot of steel. It's not quite like that. It's more with the recursive training on previous AI-generated content. But there's a problem. You see, large language models, which are essentially AI systems that can produce text, they get their content from the internet or from databases. But a study has shown that most of the text on the internet now are either just straight out created or at least translated by AI. That means that if large language models were to only get their input from the web, then they'll end up training on previous AI-generated content. And that's quite problematic. Because, well, AI-generated content isn't exactly the same as human-generated content. There's always some difference, some deviation. As you can see here, this is not exactly a pair of human hands, although it kind of does look like one at the bottom, but there are way more than 10 fingers up there. So how does this self-destruction actually work? It's a bit similar to a kid's telephone game, where the objective of the game is to transfer a phrase from the first child at one end of the line to the other child at the very end of the other, or at the other end of the line. And originally we can have the phrase, I like to eat pizza with extra cheese, totally normal phrase. The second child might think it's, I like to eat pizza with extra peas. It's not that big of a difference, but there is some meaning change in that. And the third child might think it's, I like to meet Lisa with extra bees. As you can see, the phrase is becoming more and more different. And the final child might think it's, I like to beat Lisa with extra teeth. That is quite different. So there's a lot of meaning lost in that. And AI kind of works a similar way. I mean, originally we have basically the original phrase from the children's game as the first input, the human-generated content. That's fed into the AI model, and we get an output. But remember, the output is different from human-generated content. It has some flaws, it has some mistakes. So that mistake is then carried into AI model once again. And because this model is also imperfect, it will produce even more mistakes with output number two. And that becomes a third input. So we get this, you know, vicious cycle or recursive learning pattern going on here. And eventually, as you might guess, it'll just be a complete mess with input number five or output number seven, stuff like that. So a recent study done on a large language model very similar to ChatGPT, it trained that model on a 14th century English steeple essay. So this is an English steeple. But after 9 recursive iterations of training, it actually produced a nonsense article about different color-tailed jackrabbits. And this is an AI-generated image of these jack-tailed rabbits because different colored jack-tailed rabbits don't actually exist. They just, you know, AI just straight up created its own species of animals. And, you know, now it makes sense why creative professionals like artists or writers, filmmakers and musicians really dislike AI. They might even want AI to self-destruct. But the problem is that it's not just AI that's going to be unusable and people won't ever use it again. Our information in general will be severely impacted. Our current generation is more or less intelligent. As we got most of our education before the rise of generative AI. But for future generations, that might not be the case, as all of the information online will be polluted with AI-generated content that might be really incorrect. And generated content, or generative AI, would be the biggest victims of this recursive training, but non-generative or discriminative AI would still be heavily impacted. For example, object detection and classification models that still do produce output would be affected. So if the model is fed with incorrect information or incorrectly labeled images, then it's likely to spew out also incorrectly labeled images. So while detecting a charger as a toilet and the charging wire as a pair of scissors isn't going to really end in catastrophic world-ending consequences, but this becomes much more of a problem in the real world where these models are used to detect diseases like cancer or tuberculosis, where a false negative here could be deadly. And you might be thinking, right, I'm not really an AI expert. You know, AI experts can do all sorts of stuff to kind of save this situation. You've got computer scientists and engineers. They can, you know, not only worry about the technology, about the speed of their algorithms, but also to have like preemptive measures and mechanisms to audit training data. Activists and advocates, they can be out there trying to enforce companies to disclose the sources of their data. There can be regular checks into AI models to see that, you know, they're actually doing fine and not spewing out ridiculous content. So you might feel a bit helpless. You think you can't really be a change maker, but you can. This is an image of Clay Thompson's terrible game. I watched that game, he played terribly. He shot 10 shots and made none in arguably the most important game of his team's season. And Twitter users being Twitter users were quick to criticize Clay Thompson for bricking his shots. A term in basketball known as, you know, the act of missing your shots really badly. Twitter's Gronk AI was quick to pick up on these tweets and interpret it as Clay Thompson actually vandalizing houses in Sacramento and throwing bricks at them. And this wasn't exactly what went on during that game, but a lot of Twitter users were quick to start trolling and go with the mistake. So this guy was pretending like he actually got bricked by Clay Thompson. So not being like this guy is one way to make a change. It's not that hard. And doing so is actually very damaging because, well, future AI models are going to be training on these sorts of tweets, and they're actually going to think, you know, Clay Thompson did this. And, you know, this is also not something you would love to do. You know, students, if you're using ChatGPT or other large language models to help you write your essays, make sure to cite them and be transparent when you're using them so, you know, you don't end up like this guy. But also so that AI models in the future don't start training on, you know, content that it believes is human but actually is not. So the truth is, AI is not going to take over the world soon. It's more likely to self-destruct if we don't do something about it. And we all play a role, not just AI specialists. We can't allow AI to go rogue and be the sole dictatorial change makers in our world. We have to ensure that, you know, it's not going crazy by, you know, doing these things that I just mentioned, which shouldn't really be that hard. And together, we can make sure that it's, you know, in check, and in the future, it's not going to, you know, ultimately ruin our entire internet. So if we work together, we can not only keep AI in check, but also solve Capcha tests, maybe save Clay Thompson from going to jail, or maybe, just maybe, cure a couple of deadly diseases. Thank you.